trachea is one of our airways that starts exactly below the larynx. Recall the lowest cartilage in larynx is crocoid cartilage. And we see that crocoid cartilage is connected to the first tracheal cartilage by a membrane, which is a strong, dense connective tissue membrane named cricotracheal membrane. And then when I count the number of the hyaline cartilages that we have in trachea, we notice that we have 16 to 20 of these hyaline cartilages. And these tracheal cartilages are connected to one another with some dense membrane that we have in between. When we follow trachea, we see that it starts below crocoid cartilage and it ends at the superior border of thoracic vertebral bone number 5. So exactly in the upper border of T5, we usually have the end of the trachea. The length of trachea is about 12 centimeters, that would equal 5 inches. And the diameter of trachea is about 2.5 centimeters, that would equal 1 inch. And it is very important that when we are breathing during inhalation and exhalation, we allow trachea to change its diameter. So we know that the tracheal cartilages are hyaline cartilages. They're strong. They allow a very small amount of flexibility. And mostly what we expect from these hyaline cartilages is to keep trachea open all the time. To allow trachea to have flexibility and change its diameter, we take a look at the back wall of trachea, simply because when you analyze the hyaline cartilages that we have in trachea, you notice that they have a shape that look like a capital C, which simply that means on the back wall of trachea, we do not have any cartilage. As you can see, the cartilages end and the back wall of trachea is covered by a membrane of soft tissue. In this soft tissue membrane, we have transverse smooth muscles and also we have elastic connective tissue. And that would allow trachea to change its diameter during breathing, inhalation and exhalation. In some resources, we refer to this membranous wall that we have on the back of trachea as fibromuscular membrane. So that's very important in allowing the trachea to change its diameter during pulmonary ventilation. Please keep in mind that behind larynx and trachea, we have esophagus. The next thing that I pay attention to is in the wall of trachea, we have different layers. For example, the inner layer is the mucous membrane. And when we analyze the epithelial tissue of this mucous membrane, we notice that the epithelial tissue is ciliated pseudostratified columnar epithelium. So clearly in the epithelial tissue, we have lots of goblet cells that they secrete mucus. We need secretion of mucus for conditioning the air. When we say we are conditioning the air, it simply means when air passes through these airways, we make air moist to reduce friction by adding a little bit water droplets to the air. We add to the temperature of the air while passing through these airways to adjust the temperature to the temperature inside our visceral organs, including the lungs. And also we trap debris and particles. Basically, we clean the air. Mucus is sticky. So some of the particles can actually trap in mucus. And now, since we have production of more mucus, the previous mucus that is full of debris and particles should be moved out of our airways. And having cilia in the epithelial tissue of the mucous membrane actually helps mucus to move up. That would be the job of cilia. So they bring mucus up from trachea to larynx. And then from larynx, the mucus will be moved into pharynx. As soon as mucus gets into the pharynx, with different ways, we eliminate mucus. For example, by coughing, sneezing, spitting, speaking. But most of the mucus that gets to pharynx eventually will be swallowed. It goes into esophagus and the digestive system is the one that is going to eliminate the mucus. So that is very important to know that basically using any kind of chemical that paralyzes or disrupts the movement of mucus can easily impact the movement of the mucus out of the airways, which that movement should be upward, superiorly. For example, nicotine in tobacco paralyzes the cilia, makes it difficult for the cilia of the cells that line the trachea to actually move mucus. So in those individuals, unfortunately, some of the secretion in the airways, instead of going up to be eliminated from the body, is going to move down and eventually is going to block those smaller airways that we have inside the lungs, including the respiratory bronchioles, alveolar ducts, and the pulmonary alveoli. The next thing, when we get exactly to the end of trachea, before trachea bifurcates into primary bronchi, when we analyze the mucous membrane at the end of trachea, we notice that the mucous membrane creates a ridge, and we call that carina. The cells that we have in the mucous membrane of carina are very sensitive to detecting particles and debris. As soon as particles and debris get close to the end of the trachea, carina initiate a coughing reflex. That would be an attempt to bring those particles up and do not let them to enter the lungs. Next thing that I would like to pay attention in this video would be the anatomy of the structures that are sitting close to trachea. We know that trachea is located in the midline, and in our cervical region, the neck, we can actually palpate these structures, and in some of our patients, actually, we do that. We can palpate the thyroid cartilage of larynx. We can palpate the lower border of thyroid cartilage and the upper border of crocoid cartilage. Recall here, we have a membrane that connects thyroid cartilage to crocoid cartilage, and that membrane is referred to as a cricothyroid membrane. We can palpate the crocoid cartilage and find out the lower border of the crocoid cartilage. And then we can palpate some of these tracheal cartilages. That's definitely a good practice to start palpating these anatomical structures on your own neck. And then I noticed the presence of a very important gland, thyroid gland, in the area. Thyroid gland has two lobes. In this model, I can see the left lobe, and the part of thyroid gland that connects the right and left lobe together, that would be referred to as isthmus. As you see, the isthmus of thyroid gland sits very close to the junction of larynx and trachea. On the thyroid gland, I noticed the presence of superior thyroid artery, inferior thyroid artery, and also if I go to the back of the thyroid gland, on the back I can find the parathyroid glands. We have four parathyroid glands. Obviously, in this model, I'm looking at the left ones. So these are very important anatomical structures that we see. Also, we see some nerves in the area. For example, this is a recurrent laryngeal nerve. We can see some other blood vessels. But the point here is, when we learn about these anatomical structures, when the time comes to do procedures such as cricothyrotomy or tracheostomy, we know that we're not supposed to damage any of these structures. For example, during these procedures, we need to be mindful that thyroid gland is close by. As a quick review, when we have patients that they have obstruction in their airways, especially the upper airways, or for example, the upper airways are burnt, or patients that have cancer, or in general, patients that for a variety of reasons, there is an obstruction in their airways, and we have to reestablish the airflow in and out of the lungs, we need to do some procedures to open some of the airways and insert some tubes into the airways to reestablish the airflow. Tracheostomy, which is done on a trachea, and I explain exactly in which spot, needs to be done in a hospital setting. It's recommended that a surgeon does tracheostomy simply because this is an invasive procedure. It has lots of complications, and usually we do that on the patient under general anesthesia. It is preferred that it is done in the operating room. However, we have some other health professionals that they are trained and licensed to do the tracheostomy. So that would be really opening a window, a hole into the trachea. However, sometimes before the patient is transferred into the hospital in emergency situation that the breathing is not happening because of an obstruction in the airways, before we transfer the patient to the hospital, we need to reestablish the airflow. And that would be the time that we must actually, by palpating the area, find exactly the place that thyroid cartilage meets cricothyrotomy cartilage. So basically, in this procedure, which is referred to as cricothyrotomy, exactly the cricothyroid membrane has to be cut and open. The incision is done here, and then we insert a tube directly into larynx. The tube inside is below the vocal folds, so we try to not really damage and be too close to the vocal folds. So cricothyrotomy is done exactly here, which, as I said, when we go inside the larynx, is about 1 centimeter below the vocal folds. But this is a procedure that temporarily allows the air to flow in and out of the lungs. When the patient gets to the hospital setting and we have the necessary equipments, then we need to do the tracheostomy, which right now I'm going to walk you through the steps of tracheostomy. Obviously, first step, what we do, we inject anesthetic to the area, the front of the neck. One of the landmarks that we use would be the thyroid cartilage, and we make sure that below that, we palpate the cricothyrotomy cartilage and numb this area. It is interesting that when we inject anesthetic in the area, also we inject a little bit of epinephrine. Recall, epinephrine causes vasoconstriction of the blood vessels that we have in this spot, so we end up with less hemorrhaging, less bleeding, which is an advantage. And then the next thing is we use two important landmarks to determine exactly where we have to make our incision. One would be the lower border of cricothyrotomy cartilage, so exactly here, which, as I mentioned, we can palpate this area. You can examine it on your own neck. And the other landmark would be this sternal notch, or some people refer to it as suprasternal notch on the sternum. So when you find these two landmarks, as you see in the image, then we make an incision exactly in the spot. Usually the incision is a longitudinal incision, and it's about 3 to 4 centimeters, depending on the patient. And when you open the skin, then we basically try to find those anatomical structures that were supposed to preserve, that were supposed to not damage them, including the muscles that we have in the area. Recall, we are below hyoid bone. The bone here is hyoid bone. So the muscles that we have below, we refer to them as infrahyoid muscles. So we make sure that we a little bit retract those muscles and not cut them as much as possible. Also, we have some muscles such as platysma, which is considered as one of our muscles for facial expression, because it can help us to change our facial expression, and even it participate in movement of mandible. So those are the muscles that we try to focus on and preserve. And then when we get to the area, we really must palpate and find the thyroid gland, and especially its isthmus. And we have to move the isthmus away from the area that we're going to make the final incision into the trachea. So that's the importance of knowing about the anatomy of thyroid gland and examining the thyroid gland. And please know that when we want to make the incision, we want to make sure that none of these airways or structures move accidentally suddenly. So we have to make sure that larynx really stay in its place without any movement. The incision that we make to open a space, a window into trachea, is commonly done exactly in the membrane that we have between tracheal cartilage number 2 and tracheal cartilage number 3. So for a moment, allow me to remove the thyroid gland and show you in the model that when we get in, after carefully moving away those anatomical structures, then the incision is exactly done on this membrane between tracheal cartilages 2 and 3. And then a little bit, we push these two cartilages away. We're not damaging the cartilages. We're just cutting the membrane. And then we insert the instruments that we have inside the trachea. But please keep in mind, when we insert the instrument, we must be mindful of the diameter of trachea. Basically, we do not want to damage the back wall. The instruments and eventually the tube should really get midway into trachea, and then they extend down through trachea. So this would be the steps that we take to complete tracheostomy in the patient. And the patients that they need tracheostomy are many different type of patients that we have, including the ones that for a long term we have to connect them to the ventilator machine. Ventilator machine is a machine that we use as a life support for patients that either they have difficulty to breathe in and out on their own, or there are some health conditions that makes it difficult for these patients to have a proper pulmonary ventilation. And this machine could be adjusted. We can adjust the pressure of the air. We can adjust how much oxygen gets inside the lungs, how much carbon dioxide will be removed from the lungs. So those adjustments can be made. Also, tracheostomy is done for patients, for example, that they have an extensive burn in their face and neck. It is done in patients that have cancer, or due to paralysis or neurological disorders, in those patients that the secretions of airways cannot in a natural and normal way go up into the pharynx to eventually be eliminated. We actually can connect some sort of suction to the tube and get those secretions out of the airways. So I would say that tracheostomy really is needed to help these patients to survive and hopefully overcome that health issue that they do have. But hopefully this video clarified that when we learn about an anatomical structure, for example, this video is focused on trachea, it is important and critical that we pay attention to the other structures that we have close by.